Let's have a look at the DP algorithm to create optimal linear trees. As input, we have a set of relations, of course, consisting of relations R1, R2, until Rn. So our final tree has to join these n relations. And since this is like a DP algorithm, we have to have a DP table that stores optimal solutions for subproblems. This DP table is denoted B here, and is simply a mapping from the power set of R to a join tree. This means power set of R, of course, as you all know, is the subsets, or all possible subsets of R, which means that this function here, or the B, the function which is behind B, maps a set of relations to the cheapest tree to join these relations. Right? To initialize B, we simply say that the cheapest tree for the subproblem consisting only of one relation is the relation itself. So it's not really a tree, but well, like a tree can also have only one node, which is here in this case the relation itself. Okay, that's a very simple to understand initialization. And let's start now to see how we can create larger solutions, or solutions for larger join problems. Here we're looking, starting from small values, so small problem sizes, to larger problem sizes, and we denote by S the size of the subproblem we're currently looking at. So small s is the size of the join problem. We assume we have a subset S of R. S has the size of small s minus 1. And we take one more relation which is not in S. We call this relation Ri. Remember from previous slides when we had join tree T, in case of linear trees, and we said then T consists of T prime join relation Ri. This is exactly what we do here. So S is not a join tree itself. S is only a set of relations. And we have S minus 1 relations in S. Currently, we're looking at solutions to problems of size S. That means if S, the small s, is of size more, or this big S is of size S minus 1, we have already stored the cheapest tree for set S in our dynamic programming table. Let's ignore this line and just go right away to this one here. What we do here is we're accessing our dynamic programming table B using the as input this large S, and then we obtain the best join tree for our subproblem large S. We also look up B for our problem consisting only of one relation, and trivially, we have seen already, this is simply the relation itself. It can happen, more about that later, that the tree we look up here does not exist, in which case we just ignore this for loop run and go back to look at different S problems. But let's assume it exists, and then it means that P1 is a tree and P2 is a tree. And then we're calling our utility method createJoinTree to get the cheapest tree for our problem of joining the tree, which is the best solution for S, with Ri. Now you see that what we just did was solving the problem S union Ri, right? If we put now some concrete numbers in, or concrete example in, let's say we're solving the problem R1, R3. This is now corresponding to S, just for the sake of a simple example. Union R5, let's say. Right? So the union, of course, is the set R1, R3, R5. And there's only one way to look at this problem, to say we have a tree for this one and we join it with this. We could also say, well, we have a tree for R1, R5, and we join it with R3. So there are different ways how to solve this big problem. That means that there are multiple ways to consider, as we have discussed on the slide regarding this equation here. So there are multiple ways, or all ways need to be considered, how you can express this problem using joint trees. And this means, when we are looking at this problem, S union Ri, we only look here in one situation, in one run, only at one specific way to come up with a joint tree. We will come later on, when we're repeating this for loop for different S's, again here, and overall we need to find the cheapest tree for the problem S union Ri. And here is where the updating of the dynamic programming table comes in, because when we look at this problem, S union Ri, and this is the first time we look at the problem, then we store the tree P that we just created as the cheapest solution. Or, even if it's not the first time we're looking at this, but we have seen already the problem earlier, however, the tree P that we are currently looking at is cheaper than the solution we have previously stored in B for the same problem S union Ri. In which case, of course, we update our DP table B to point now for our problem S union Ri to the new tree we have computed. In the end, after we have solved this inner for loop, we have looked at all possible ways to join or to solve the problem S union Ri. And by this updating here, we can guarantee that the entry B for the subproblem S union Ri contains the cheapest tree. Then we go on for the next problem by increasing the size of the problems we're looking at from S to S plus 1, small s in this case. So that's all needs to be said here. Of course, in the end, what we return is the entry of the DP table corresponding to our global problem, which is the set of relations R1 to Rn. Now you might wonder, because this algorithm looks very simple, of course there is like the problem still to be, when you're implementing this, to be considered, how can you guarantee or how can you implement this that you're looking at all possible subsets, which can be very easy to implement if you're doing it brute force, when you're allowing cross products or you have a click join graph. But if you have not allowed cross products, and let's say you have like a chain query, so R1 can be joined only with R2 and so on, then coming up with different ways here with S and Ri is not so trivial. And now let's come back to the two lines I have, or this one line I have dropped from the discussion, namely this one. You see that if you're looking at a problem where you want to have S union Ri solved, and to find the cheapest joint tree to solve this, but S is not connected in our join graph with Ri, and we do not allow cross products, we cannot address this problem, because there's no way to join S with Ri. S not connected with Ri means that in S, which is a set of relations, there's no relation that has an edge in the query graph with Ri. So we cannot address this problem unless we allow cross products. But if we don't have cross products and we don't have this connection, we have to continue. So we will not investigate the following lines. We jump right away to the next iteration of this for loop. So again, here's some text. I think I mentioned all of this already. You can read that, maybe that helps, but essentially I have said this already. When you're looking at the for loops, of course, we see that we are always looking at larger problems and larger problems, starting from small problems. The order in which the subtrees are generated doesn't really matter, except, of course, for the following requirement. So if you have a subset of this entire set of relations, R1 to Rn, and S is a subset, and we want to compute now the best joint tree for S, all joint trees for subsets of S have to be already generated. Otherwise, we cannot make use of this finding the cheapest tree of the subproblem by accessing the DP table B, which should be kind of obvious. Now let's turn our attention to the generation of bushy trees. So we are not restricted anymore to linear trees. As we have seen earlier, for the linear tree, we had T, or for the left deep tree, we had T consisting of a T prime and a join with Ri, right? So now we're looking at bushy trees, so this is not anymore the case. Here, we're looking at the tree T, of course, with more than two relations. And these bushy trees of the form T1 join T2, where these Ti can be full-fledged joint trees, they can also be relations, of course, but this restriction that one has to be a relation, or T2 has to be a relation here, is not anymore there. So T1 and T2 can be trees. If T is optimal, then T1 and T2 have to be optimal too, right? Because if T was optimal, so the cheapest possible, or among the cheapest, if there are multiple cheapest, so if T is optimal, and T1 would not be optimal, we could come up with a better T1, let's call it T1 prime, and then the tree T1 prime join T2 would be cheaper than T, which would be violating our assumption that T is optimal, right? That means if T is optimal, T1 and T2 need to be optimal too. But it is not the case. Remember the discussion about the search space? It is not the case that if you're taking an optimal T1 and an optimal T2, and you're just joining them, that this is automatically also the optimal T. So the again here, we have to iterate over all possible ways to look at T by combining optimal trees T1 and T2. Of course, T1 and T2 need to be optimal, as we have said here. But we still have to look at all possible pairs of optimal trees T1 and T2. Not just any, that's important. So now here you see the DP algorithm for arbitrary bushy trees, so not restricted to linear trees as before. And this algorithm looks very much the same, very similar, yeah, right? Of course, we have an input set of relations we want to join, and the cost function C, according to which we want to find the cheapest tree. We have again our DP table B, with the same mapping from the power set of R to the cheapest join tree, and we're building this up again, bottom up. We initialize this again, saying that the cheapest tree for the problem of consisting only of one relation is the relation itself. And now again, we look at subproblems of size small s, and we go here in an ascending way, so it means bottom up, we look at small problems and then larger problems. If you're comparing the algorithm, you're printing it, or you're taking some tool to look at both algorithms at the same time, you will see that here, this is always the same, not syntactically the same, but it's the same idea to update the DP table to keep track about the cheapest solution for our subproblem. Earlier, the subproblem looked like S union Ri. Now, since we are not restricted to linear trees, our subproblem consists of two sets, S1 and S2. That means we are solving the problem S1 union S2. Together, S1 and S2, if you sum up the cardinalities, has to be small s, which denotes the size of our subproblem we're looking at. These sets S1 and S2 have to be disjoint, of course, right? You don't want to have a relation which is on the left and the right side of the join input. If S1 and S2 are not connected, that means there is no relation in the one side and the other side of our join. That means in S1 and S2 with an edge in the query graph, and we do not allow cross products, we have to jump over this specific choice of S1 and S2 and continue for the next S1 and S2. Right, so we continue our loop. So let's assume that they are connected or we allow cross products. And what we do now, not surprisingly, we look up our table B to find the cheapest plan for subproblem S1 and the cheapest plan for subproblem S2. We denote these trees with P1 and P2. In case one of the two is null, so doesn't exist, we also continue with our for loop. But let's assume that we have the trees given. Then we call our create join tree method, which gives us the best way to join these two join trees, P1 and P2. And now, of course, we have to update the DP table B in case we have not looked at the problem S1, S2 before, or the solution that we have seen previously, which is stored here, is more costly than our current tree P. In these two cases, we denote as the entry for our subproblem S1 and S2 the currently found tree P. Of course, even if we update the B table, doesn't mean that P is the overall cheapest way to join S1 and S2, or to solve the join problem S1 union S2, to be precise, because we can come back here for another choice of S1, S2, which is the same problem we consider, S1 and S2, and can be even cheaper, right? But in the end, if you're looking at all possible ways, we come up, or we are guaranteed that we're finding for all possible subsets the cheapest tree. And in the end, where's our solution? Well, it's here. It's the entry of B for the set corresponding to the global set of relations R1 to Rn. It is important, also for the previous algorithm and for the entire discussion about DP tables and how to use them, it's important to see that in this iteration here, we are solving one, or we're looking at one specific problem, which is problem of joining relations in S1 union S2. And we're looking at one specific way to do that, namely having one tree for S1 and one tree for S2. There are multiple ways to solve this problem of the union, and solving this by a tree for S1 and S2 is only one way. Right? So if you have R1, R2, R3, and R4, maybe let's say there's more, it goes up until R whatever, 15. So you have a huge input. And this is our subproblem. Let's say S1 union S2 corresponds to these four relations. And then there's one solution would be to say S1 corresponds to R1 and R3, and S2 corresponds to R2 and R4. And we can join the cheapest tree for S1 and S2. Another possibility is to address the problem R1 to R4 to say S1 consists of R, let's say 3. and S2 consists of R1, R2, R4, and so on, right? So it's always the same problem. You want to solve in this step here, you want to solve the problem to compute the cheapest tree to solve the join problem consisting of relations R1, R2, R3, and R4. See, when I say that, it's a set of relations R1, R2, R3, and R4. There's no no notation of what the tree looks like, because there are multiple trees. And every iteration here looks at it, at the at the join problem for S1 union S2. And by iterating over all possible ways S1 and S2 can look like for a certain problem, we guarantee that in the end we have the cheapest tree. And of course, as you can imagine, these two are only two, but there are more, right? You can also have R1 and R4 and R2 and R3. And by looking at all possible ways, you can guarantee in the end that you're finding the cheapest tree overall. And the cool thing about DP is that no matter if this is R S1 and this is S2, you can always go and look up in the dynamic programming table to find the cheapest tree. And then you can compute the cost of the tree, and if this tree is the best tree for our join problem, then we can update our DP table. There are more approaches to join order optimization. Particularly, there exists an entire family of randomized algorithms. They will not look at the search space in a greedy or in a DP style way, but they would create plans randomly. And then depending on the algorithm, there are different variations. So you can create this the plan randomly, and then you make minor modifications to the tree. You can run the algorithm multiple times, and then you're picking the tree which is the cheapest one from the picked and modified ones. There are different approaches behind this family of randomized approaches, for instance, hill climbing, iterative improvement, and so on. We will not look at these in detail. Also, it sounds kind of easy to or cheap, let's say, to come up with randomized random trees. It's also not so easy because you have to make sure that the way you're generating random trees is also like uniformly looking at the entire search space and is not coming close to what we have seen already when we investigated these greedy approaches. So it's also not that easy. Also, it sounds maybe easier than dynamic programming, right? But it's also not for free. And yeah, that's all I wanted to say on these randomized approaches.